Hi, and welcome to this episode of Inside the Mind of an Actuary. It's my pleasure to have on the line Linh Nguyen. She is an actuary. She's been in the insurance realm for many years. Thanks for joining us today.
Hey, Mark. Really a pleasure for me to be invited to your Inside the Mind of an Actuary series. And it was great meeting you at the NAOBA conference.
Yeah, and that's kind of, we have an interesting backstory where even though we're both actuaries, we both attended the distribution conference and we're talking to BGAs and agents and advisors out there. And so as we were talking there, I thought, what would be a great topic to cover, but how does life insurance get priced for all the distributors out there that want to learn more about it? So today, I'd love to hear your insights. But before we get into that, I want to hear a little bit of your background. How did you get into the actuarial profession?
I actually grew up in Vietnam, and I did not know, have any idea what an actuary does. And I actually went to study in high school in Singapore and ended up in the U.S. At a college in Iowa where fortunately they had an actuarial program, and I was kind of inadvertently recruited into taking the first actuarial exam.
Yeah, what did you think about the first exam? Did you think it would be an easy path or a hard path?
I definitely thought the first exam was a piece of cake, which, you know, gave me the wrong impression of the actuarial profession at that point. I thought it would be, just a cakewalk from that point on, but I was terribly wrong. With the next exams, with each exam, it grew exponentially harder.
Yeah, they kind of like pull you in that way, right? You feel like, oh, this, I can do this, it's easier. And then as you go in, you're like, it gets more competitive and a lot harder. But I'm glad, you know, you made it all the way through. And being in Iowa, of course, there's a lot of life insurance companies out in Iowa. Is that where you began your career in the insurance world?
Yes, definitely. Right out of college, I started my career at an insurance company in Iowa. And I had the opportunity to move internally to another department in the Dallas area, and that's where I am right now. But a couple years ago, I decided that I wanted to take my career to the consulting side, and I wanted to take up the challenge of handling, you know, a variety of different products and a variety of different hats that the actuary can play.
Very cool. Well, I want to focus today a little bit on your expertise in pricing of life insurance products. And I know you have some interesting stories and clients that you've worked with. Let's start off by talking about some of the fundamental aspects of pricing. Let's say you're pricing a term life insurance product. What are the considerations that go into it when you're designing that?
Yes, definitely. The first thing that I would ask the carrier is, you know, what are the features that they would like to offer on this product? You know, is it going to be just a pure vanilla term product, or do they want to offer, you know, a unique kind of rider or some unique features with the product?
Okay. And then you've got to have a sense of, you know, what the product is designed to do and who the target market is. And then I would say fundamentally, what components go into the actual pricing aspect of it?
Right. So, as actuaries, we price from first principles. And so the most important is the developing the assumptions that go into a product. And for a term product, for example, we would first look at the mortality assumption, which is the key assumption here. And so it really depends on what kind of underwriting guidelines the carrier is offering with its product. Because, you know, for example, a guaranteed issue product is going to have much worse mortality than a simplified issue, and that would be much worse than a fully underwritten product. So many considerations that we have to take into account to come up with the correct mortality assumptions.
I see. So you're analyzing the life expectancy for that pool of business and figuring out where to price that at. And then what other kind of major assumptions are there that you're using for pricing a life insurance product?
Yeah, another very important assumption is the earned rate assumption, which is the rate that the carrier is expecting to earn on their asset portfolio that's supporting this product. Obviously, the higher the earned rate, you know, the better the asset portfolio yields, you know, the lower you can afford to price the product to make it more competitive.
I see. And then, of course, there's this competing dynamic, of course, with what the other competitor products have on the market and how you're fundamentally pricing it. Do you ever get conflicts between, you know, what distribution or executives want you to price it at and what the fundamentals dictate, and how do you resolve that?
Yes, definitely. A lot of stakeholders are at play here. You know, you have pressure from the carrier to keep a hurdle rate, you know, a minimum rate of return on the product, on their capital, but then you have pressure from the distribution side to keep it competitive. And sometimes, you know, they just, as an actuary, I just can't do both. But fortunately, you know, we have a actuarially acceptable range of assumptions that we can use, and, you know, a sliding scale of possible solutions for the stakeholders to kind of all meet in the middle. Right. So it comes down to a lot of communication and making sure all the parties understand what's happening.
Very cool. And yeah, you kind of put it this way to me, that it's not a point estimate, right? It's a broad spectrum. So if you're going to make it more competitive, then maybe that's going to cut into the carrier's margins, and they have to decide for themselves, is that something that they're willing to do, you know, to get the product on the shelf or in a certain distribution channel, or, you know, in terms of selling, making it sell better for them. So let's talk a little bit about like whole life and universal life cash value products. Is the process pretty much the same, or are there a lot of other considerations now that you have that accumulation component to the products?
Yeah, so the accumulation component definitely introduces other complexities, you know, with regulatory requirements of, you know, minimum cash accumulation value. So you have to take into account that, as well as, you know, if there's any additional features that you're offering with your cash accumulation products, you have to take that into account as well. And most importantly is your minimum crediting rate and your crediting rate strategy. You know, how much are you willing to guarantee to make your product competitive, but still being able to support it with your earned rate on your portfolio over the long run?
Right. So the term product, of course, you know, is kind of quote unquote use it or lose it, right? You're not expecting to use it or get a return back. With those accumulation products, of course, you have that return component. And so, of course, your crediting rate becomes much more important in those scenarios.
Yes.
You've also talked a little bit to me about reserving, and which means, of course, how much the insurance company holds so they can pay out the future benefits. How does kind of that reserving component affect a cash value product versus a term product?
Yeah, so the reserving and capital requirements on those products are a lot more complex and definitely, you know, very capital intensive products. So you really have to, you know, it's you really have to make sure that you're following the guidelines of, you know, all the different states to make sure that your products will actually be approved by the states, but also make sure that your products will meet the requirements of the distributor and your carriers. So it's a very complex situation.
Okay. Well, let's like kind of add some, you know, reality to this. I know you were working with the client and you were developing for them a product. Tell us a little bit about the product and why the carrier came to you as a consultant to help them price this product.
Yeah, definitely. A client had come to me with the hope of kind of creating a new product that can compete with one of their competitors on one of the products that they had already launched. And, you know, so we were able to look up publicly available information about this product that the competitor is selling. We were able to see their illustrations for their, it's a group universal life product, and kind of work our way from there to create a product from first principles.
Very cool. So initially you're reverse engineering almost the competitor's product, but then you also have to marry that with what's fundamentally sound for pricing it on its own basis. So kind of what are the considerations? Now we're talking about a group. And so what is group? What does that mean exactly?
So this group product in particular offer simplified issue underwriting. So you only have to answer a few questions on your health questionnaire and the product is issued. So the mortality expectations are definitely much higher than a fully underwritten individual product. So we, you know, took that into account. And, you know, for a group product, you know, of this caliber, you know, the competitor was offering a host of, you know, very complex riders that come with this product. So we definitely had to offer the same options or, you know, this product won't even be put on the shelf, right? Because if it doesn't offer the same riders as the competitor's product.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And so like you probably, you know, priced it fundamentally. Were there any issues you ran into when you were pricing it from a fundamental perspective and what you were seeing that the other carrier was doing in the marketplace?
Yeah, so the competitor's product illustrations were very generous with the credited rate and the minimum guaranteed crediting rates, you know, of 3%, you know, for today's environment, that's almost impossible to achieve with today's earned rates on the asset portfolios. And, you know, it was difficult to make the distribution side understand that, you know, we simply cannot offer such a high minimum guaranteed rate. So our illustration will not look nearly as good as the competitors because of, you know, we have to go with the current assumption.
Right. It's an interesting dynamic, especially for products that were priced many years ago, right? They were fundamentally sound, but over time, you know, maybe they've become a little bit outside of you know, what the current dynamic is. Some carriers you're seeing repricing even, you know, as soon as 3 months after they priced previously, just because of what's going on economically today.
Exactly.
But it's a tough dynamic. It's almost a game of chicken. It's like, do you price it higher and hope the market comes to you fundamentally, or do you price it more competitively and then hope to adjust later, or obviously keep the profit margin sound? So what were kind of were you willing to like price it more aggressively, or was a carrier management willing to do things to make it more competitive, or how did you find that balance between the two?
Yeah, so it really comes down to, you know, what are the goals that the carrier is willing to achieve? Are they just wishing to, you know, fill their product on the shelf, you know, and fill the top line, or do they want a, you know, really sound product that will bring their bottom line up over the long run? So I think, ultimately, the carrier decided to price it using the conservative current assumptions and have a profitable and sound product.
Right. And also, of course, the regulators want to make sure it's stable and that the reserves you're holding are adequate. So it's a very interesting story. I'm sure a lot of people out there that are not familiar with the actuarial world, this has kind of given them a lot of insight into it. So I really appreciate your time today, and hopefully we can kind of share some more insight into the mind of an actuary in future episodes, if you don't mind.
Of course. Thank you so much for inviting me again, Marc.